Good morning, everyone. We will be this topic is on the 6-minute walk test. The presentation is covering aspects of the 6-minute walk test, the BOG score, board index, and also heart rate recovery in patients with IPF. Generally, when a patient comes to the OPD to assess their functional status, we tend to ask them questions like, how many flights of stairs can you climb, or how many blocks can you walk? But this causes the recollection to vary from person to person, and the way they report it to us can result in either underestimation or overestimation of their functional status. So therefore, objective methods are preferred because they're better, and better methods of assessing functional exercise capacity. In the beginning, when they started this kind of testing, they started with a 12-minute walk test to assess the physical fitness of patients. But to include patients with respiratory disease for whom a 12-minute was too exhausting, they switched over to a more feasible and more friendly 6-minute walk test. Walking is chosen as an activity of choice because it is performed daily by almost all patients, except perhaps the most severely impaired patient. It evaluates the global and integrated response of all the systems involved during exercise. So here we get an overview of the pulmonary and the cardiovascular systems, the systemic circulation, peripheral circulation, blood, the neuromuscular units, and muscle metabolism, all of which is working together to help a patient, help a person to walk. A 6-minute walk test assesses the submaximal level of functional capacity, because most patients do not achieve a maximal exercise capacity while performing the 6-minute walk test. During the walk test, patients choose their own intensity of doing the exercise, and they're allowed to stop and rest during the test. But because, just like this test, most activities of daily living are also performed at a submaximal level of exertion, the 6-minute walk distance better reflects the functional exercise level for daily physical activities. There are many indications for when we prescribe a 6-minute walk test. The most common one is to assess the functional status of a patient pre-treatment and post-treatment and draw comparisons between the two, like before and after a lung transplantation, lung resection, volume reduction surgery, after a stint of pulmonary rehabilitation in a patient with COPD, pulmonary hypertension, or heart failure. We also use it as a single one-time measurement for assessing the functional status in patients with lung conditions like COPD, heart cystic fibrosis, also in patients with heart failure, peripheral vascular disease, fibromyalgia, and in older patients. It can be used as a predictor of morbidity and mortality, and also in patients with heart failure, COPD, or primary pulmonary hypertension. Contraindications for performing the 6-minute walk test would be a person who has suffered from an unstable angina or a myocardial infarction during just the previous month prior to testing. Relative contraindications are those with a resting heart rate of more than 120 or a systolic of more than 180 and a diastolic of more than 100. However, they are put as relative contraindications because reports say that plenty of times we actually do perform the test in patients with vitals like this, and mostly patients manage to complete them successfully. The requirements for performing a 6-minute walk test are fairly simple. You need a 100 feet long hallway, a countdown timer or a stopwatch, a mechanical lap counter, two small bright cones to mark the turning points where the patient has to turn, a sphygmomanometer, and in cases of emergency, it is good to have a source of oxygen and a defibrillator close by. This is a picture of how the test is performed with the help of a long, clear hallway. The walking course is preferably at least 30 meters long, and the length is marked with bright color every 3 meters. A shorter corridor requires, the rationale behind that is so that a shorter corridor actually requires the patient to take more time to reverse the directions when he reaches the cone. And therefore, it reduces the overall distance traveled by the patient. This is a schematic view, I mean, a diagram showing the same. The two black dots here and here represent the two cones that are kept. One is the starting point here where the individual starts. This is the path along which he walks, he takes a turn after the second cone and then reaches back to the starting point and repeats it all over again. Each time he takes a turn, we count the number of laps on our lap counter. If the weather is good and the and we have a flat surface outside, this test can also be performed outdoors. The nice things about this test is no exercise equipment is required and no advanced training is required for the technicians who are monitoring the performance of this test. Safety, it is better to perform the test where help is available, and all the people involved in the performance of the test should be aware of the crash cart location. Oxygen and anti-angina medication should be available readily at hand. It's nice to have a telephone to call for help in case of any adverse events. And also, the technician should be certified in performing BLS if a patient arrests while performing the test. To prepare the patient, we make sure they are in comfortable clothing, wearing appropriate shoes. If it is an old patient who routinely uses a walker or a walking aid, then the same equipment is used while performing the test as well. They can take their normal medication as usual in the morning along with a light meal, and preferably no exercise to be done 2 hours prior to the performance of a 6-minute walk test. Instructions, we tell them that the aim is to walk as far as possible in the 6 minutes allotted. It will involve walking back and forth in this hallway. We tell the patients that they will probably experience exhaustion or fatigue, and if they do so, they are allowed to slow down and even stop by leaning against the wall, but they are encouraged to resume walking as soon as possible. They are encouraged to pivot briskly around the cones without hesitating. And to show how that is done, before they start the test, we can demonstrate if required. And we start with the patient, stand with the patient at the start line. However, it is better if we don't walk with the patient, so the patient can set their own pace and walk at a speed that is comfortable for them. It is very important to encourage the patient. The guidelines actually say that we offer encouragement to the patient at the end of every minute, saying, good job, sir, 1 minute, you have 5 more minutes, 1 minute is over, you're doing well, and things like that. Because studies have shown that with encouragement, patients tend to walk a greater distance and also fatigue less and finish better. Mark the place at the end of 6 minutes. We mark the place where the patient is stopped. We congratulate them and offer them something to drink. And if they want, they can sit at the spot at which they have finished the test. When do we step in and stop the patient from continuing the test? If they complain of chest pain, intolerable dyspnea, have leg cramps, they start staggering, sweating profusely, have a pale or ashen appearance, then it might be time to step in and stop the patient from completing the test. So it is important to recognize these signs and intervene at a timely moment. So why not just use a treadmill? By using a treadmill, we can probably save the space. We will only require the space required to store the treadmill. And also the treadmill comes with devices that can constantly monitor heart rate and distance covered. But the problem is with the treadmill, it's the machine that sets the pace rather, and the patient cannot pace themselves. And so studies report that the distance walked in a treadmill can be up to 14% less than when the patient is doing it at his or her own pace in a relaxed environment as provided by the 6-minute walk test. And therefore, treadmill results are not interchangeable with corridor results. What the 6-minute walk test does not do: it cannot determine the peak oxygen uptake, nor can it diagnose the cause of dyspnea or evaluate the causes or mechanism of exercise limitation. It is only used as a complement to cardiopulmonary testing. Interpretation, with the help of a 6-minute walk test report, we can assess the performance of a patient before and after therapy. And also, it is good to keep in mind while interpreting these results that factors like age, height, weight, and sex independently affect the 6-minute walk distance in healthy adults. And these factors should be taken into consideration while interpreting the results of single measurements. Now, going on to the BOG scale, when we use the BOG scale in the 6-minute walk test is, okay, so this is a test which was created by Dr. Gunnar Borg, and it's a perceived exertion scale, and it's a reliable indicator of exercise intensity. Here, this is the chart which shows both the BOG scale, which was the original one created by Borg in 1982, and also the modified BOG scale. The difference between the two is the original scale scores all the way from 6 to 20, whereas the modified scale goes from 0 to 10. So here the scores graded from a lower number to a higher number gradually shows increase in the severity of symptoms, both breathing difficulty as well as fatigue. So a score of 6 would indicate that it's a very light strain. The patient finds it somewhat easy to breathe, or the fatigue is not so much. Whereas towards 10, it's very, very hard for the patient to breathe. He feels extremely tired and feels like he has reached the maximum possible exercise that he can do. So multiplying the score by 10 gives an approximate of the heart rate. This scale is usually printed on a heavy or laminated piece of paper, and we make the patient sit down and grade the shortness of breath before the start of the 6-minute walk test. And at the end of the scale, at the end of the test, we again offer the scale to the patient and ask the patient to score his fatigue and shortness of breath at the completion of the 6-minute walk test. And then we can compare it to the pre-test scores or values that have been entered. Now, coming to the BOD index, the BOD index is named thus because of the BODE, which stands for Body Mass Index, Airflow Obstruction, Dyspnea, and also Exercise Capacity. It's a multifactorial scoring scale which looks at the FEV1, 6-minute walk distance, the MMRC for dyspnea, and also the body mass index. Each value has a score ranging from 0 to 3, and the patient is appropriately graded, and we calculate the total points at the end. When do we use it? We can use this BOD index as a mortality predictor in patients who are suffering from COPD, and it helps to calculate the approximate 4-year survival in roughly this manner. If a person has scored between 0 to 2 points, they have a 80% 4-year survival rate. And as the score increases, the survival rate markedly decreases. And we see that in patients with a BOD index of as high as 7 to 10, their 4-year survival is as low as 18%. It can also be used as one of the criteria for deciding when a patient with very severe COPD needs a lung transplant. Typically in patients with a BOD index ranging from 7 to 10, along with other criteria, like in a patient with COPD who has history of hospitalization for exacerbation associated with acute hypercapnia, with a PCO2 of more than 50 mmHg, in patients with pulmonary hypertension, cor pulmonale, or both, despite having received oxygen therapy, and also in those whose FEV1 is less than 20% and either DLCO of less than 20% or homogeneous distribution of emphysema. So when do we not use the BOD index? In patients who are suffering from an acute exacerbation, it is not wise to use the BOD index in the middle of that exacerbation, or those who are suffering from a recent MI or unstable angina, who have a diagnosis of asthma, and those who have congestive heart failure. Now coming over to the application of the heart rate recovery in patients with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. In the year 2006 to 2009, a retrospective study was conducted and published later in the Chest Journal, which reported that the heart rate recovery of a person after they have completed 6-minute walk test tends to predict the survival in patients with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. And this article, this is a retrospective study, and a 6-minute walk test was actually performed in these patients earlier as part of their clinical evaluation. The study subjects wore pulse oximeters, and recordings were taken at the end of 6-minute walk test after 1 minute of rest. So in patients who have completed the test, if the heart rate recovery, the absence of a fall in the heart rate by greater than 13 beats per minute, 1 minute after the performance of the 6 minute walk test, tended to be associated with increased mortality in patients who are suffering with IPF, and also added independent prognostic information beyond provided by baseline demographic and physiologic data. This is a this is a tabular column showing the same results, but the implication of that summarizes into the failure of heart rate to drop by more than 13 beats per minute at 1 minute after completing a 6 minute walk test is a poor prognostic marker. Thank you.